morning.
Good morning.
I wish I could get this respect at home. I love this. How are you?
Good.
How was algebra?
Outstanding, ma'am.
Hard.
Terrible.
But this will be more fun, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Excellent. Excellent. So, everybody take a deep breath. Exhale. And before we get started, I think that Megan deserves a big round of applause for her stepping up and volunteering at this momentous occasion to lead us for the Roman 6 presentation. So it's going to be very casual. It's going to be fun. You're going to learn along the way. Quick question. When we talked about Socrates, we said it's all about the questions, not the
answers.
So I have a question for you, but it does deserve an answer. Let's see who can get close. I'm not going to give the answer because we are going to, it's going to be discussed. How many people are in a legion? How many Roman soldiers are in a legion? Just a guess. 30. What else? How many?
Six.
No, more than six.
100 plus.
Okay. We need to be specific, right?
600.
Can I get a 700?
No.
701.
1,005.
Way more. Way more.
I'll take it.
Excellent. Excellent. So, you're going to find out today that and more. Did you bring your questions as instructed?
We have them right now.
Excellent. That's very good. It's going to be lively. It's going to be interactive. And afterwards, we are going to go outside and you will be able to get your pictures taken. Okay, so you will have that. And I would like to introduce Lorianne Hamley, who will also be...
Good morning,
is the Yoda of the Legion 6. She's my go-to person because I go to her for all questions. So if you want to say anything now, you're welcome to, and then we'll go into Megan's introduction.
Well, I'd like to say that, yeah, we want to make this interactive because I think one of the most important things is to make this an educational experience, so not just a straight lecture. So if you have any questions, please feel free to raise your hand or... And then we can address them, because I know sometimes after you sit for a while, we tend to forget things. So please feel free. It is your class, and anything that comes to mind you want to know, you want to handle, that's fine, okay?
Also, because we're filming, if there is a reason or a need to go outside of the classroom, absolutely, you don't need permission to do this, but please exit the rear side and then go out this side, okay? So you're not interrupting the filming. Okay? Any questions? Okay? Sit back and enjoy. Mm-hmm. Megan.
Give me 1 second, ma'am. Okay. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming to today's exciting event by the members of the Legion 6 Historical Foundation. I'm Cadet Billington, a student at the Police Orientation Preparation Program, and it's in conjunction with Los Angeles College. And this presentation is with Professor Winter's Spring Semester Humanities course entitled People and Their World, Technology and Humanities. For those of you who are not familiar with these terms, technology technology is derived from the Greek word techne, which means craft or skill, and the humanities are comprised of disciplines or subjects of art, including painting, sculptures, dancing, theater, architecture. It also includes art history, music, philosophy, and language arts, which is like foreign languages. This course relates to technology to the humanities. It covers and provides opportunities to examine the interaction between society and technology, challenging and stimulating questions about cultural and social values. In light of these effects of technology from the Paleolithic period to the 21st century are developed and discussed. In this semester, we are studying some of the vast contributions of the ancient civilizations of Mesopotamia, Egypt, Greece, Rome, and the medieval period. To make connections with our modern civilization, through the prism of various topics, which is communications, medicine, sports and leisure, military technology, and transportation. Today's presentation by Legion 6 is part of the military technology component of the course, where we make connections between ancient and present day inventions. Everything you see and use was already created, molded, and made by ancient civilizations. When these civilizations died out, along with their people, they left an enormous array of their best and brightest inventions that we are beneficiaries of. Today, we will have an opportunity to glance in the window of Roman civilization through Legion 6 Historical Foundation. 20 centuries ago, the Legion 6 Victorious distinguished itself as a fighting and civilizing force, bringing the enemies of Rome to heel and teaching them the benefits of civilization. Today's Legion 6 recreates a garrison camp near the Roman city of modern York in England in the province of Britannia. Their members portray the foot soldiers and officers of the Legion, imperial officials, and the civilians of Roman province. Their basic time frame is 122 to 138 AD during the reign of the Emperor Hadrian. Although subunits portray Legion 6 during the Republic and late Empire as well, they strive to inform, educate, entertain both themselves and the public, and to have lots of fun along the way. Towards these goals, they take part in film and television productions, military timelines, historical fairs, and other special events, as well as give educational presentations throughout Southern California. To stay sharp, they conduct drills and marches in full kit once each month. They also take part in experimental archaeology to help historians investigate how Romans may have done things. Finally, they enjoy the friendship that has shared their fascination with this important historical era. The Legion 6 Historical Foundation has sent members to speak today and provide static and interactive information that demonstrates the strategy, tactics, logics, and material of the Imperial Romani Army during Roman Emperor Hadrian's era. The members will also discuss the history of the police force in Roman society from its roots in the Greek word polis, meaning city, and its adaptation as a term to describe the system of civil administration to the creation of specific branches of military services, service guards, and civil organization that perform some of the duties that our modern forces do today. Their goals are to acquaint you with the early history of policing and the Roman fire barrage, and to demonstrate how the U.S. police in the larger perspective, the criminal justice system, and Western world evolved from English law enforcement experience, which itself inherited many of the institutions of the Roman heritage. The speakers are presented in full period equipment and bring along items of field gear for presentation. They also address questions previously submitted by the POPP students present today as part of the humanities course assignment. Please have a warm welcome for Legion 6 representatives you see before you. They will introduce themselves in Roman character and in 21st century real time.
Are any of you understanding any of what I just said? No, sir.
I'll have to use your local barbaric dialect then. I accept that we live out in the provinces and not everybody speaks the emperor's Latin, which is the language I was just speaking in. Our emperor, of course, is the great Hadrian, Hadrianus Augustus, ruler of the world as we know it. And here we are in Britannia province on the far fringes of the empire, and we are going to teach you how to be Roman soldiers. Is that clear?
Yes, yes sir.
You would respond, Ita Domine. I am your Domine, I am your Lord. Domine means Lord, and I would be your Lord as your officer, as your centurio. Is that clear?
Ita Domine.
Bonum, bonum.
Okay, well, so now we step through the time-space continuum, so let me just take a brief moment to introduce these gentlemen here that will be lording it over you. So the loquacious one here on the far left, or your right, is Mr. David Michaels, the president of the Legion 6 Historical Foundation. He is the Centurio Prima Pilis, the most high-ranking centurion. His name for his character is Titus Flavius Crispus. For the record, my name is Lorianne Hambley, and I did not come in my Roman kit today, but I play a character named Pompeia Pulchra, who is the wife of the centurion, or centurio.
Mia esposa.
Yes. The uxor is the Latin word. This gentleman to my left is Mr. Matthew Bowes. He is our ballistarius, or our, I guess, the manager of heavy artillery for the unit. Mr. Michael Long, he is our aquilifer. And Mr. John Long, he's our signifer.
And the Roman names are? Julius Longinus, these are the brothers Longinus, Marcus Longinus, and Titus Pontius Cominius. So everybody here has a Roman name in addition to their modern Latin name. Now, this class is called Technologies or Humanities and Technology. Technology in Humanity. The Romans, 2,000 plus years ago, built an empire that spanned just about everything we know of in Europe. They ruled North Africa, they ruled Syria, what we now call Israel, Egypt, all of this was part of the empire, Turkey, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, Britain, England, Spain, all of it came under the purview of the Roman Empire. And they ruled it all as one giant entity for more than 500 years. People talk about the fall of the Roman Empire. Oh, isn't it a terrible thing? The Roman Empire, the one thing everybody knows about the Roman Empire is that it fell. The more amazing thing is not that it fell, but that it held on for 500 years. This was a time when there were no telephones, no quick ways to travel around, no airplanes, no transport, no steamships, no trains, no cars, none of this, no way to communicate quickly, and yet still, somehow, this empire remained a intact political entity for more than 500 years. That's a huge achievement. Now, what made that possible? These guys made that possible. The Roman army. They're the ones that conquered the empire. They're ones that made it all part of one big unity. And then once it was conquered, they're the ones that held it together and policed it. You are, gentlemen, all you are in training to become gentlemen and ladies, sorors and fratres, brothers and sisters, you are here in training to become police officers. Well, the Roman army was the police force that held this entire empire together. And then each individual cities, there were hundreds, thousands of cities within the Roman Empire. Many of them had police forces of their own, including the city of Rome, which our lovely Pompeia will speak about in a little bit. But first, we're going to talk about the army itself. Numerous. Scuta dorsum. Otio se. That little spiel I gave at the beginning. I am Titus Flavius Crispus. I am a senior centurio, centurio prima pilis, in Legion 6 Victrix Pia Fidelis, the 6th Legion, victorious, loyal, and faithful. That's what all that means. Now, people ask, what does a Roman soldier look like? I mean, people have seen them in movies. You see them in movies, on TV. You see representations of them everywhere. And asking that question is a little like saying, well, what does an American soldier look like? What did he look like in the Civil War? What did he look like in World War I? What did he look like in World War II? What does he look like now? It's completely different. And depending on what slice of time you take, a soldier can look totally different. Their equipment can be different. They can carry different gear. Their armor and equipment can be different. So we will, for a moment, examine what a Roman army looked like at the very peak of the empire. And you could say the peak of the empire was in the reign of our Emperor Hadrian. This was at a time when just about all of the Mediterranean world was under Roman control. The empire was at peace. There were not many wars going on, little brush fire conflicts here and there, but there were no massive, great, big wars going on. And the reason that was is because the Romans had pretty much exhausted all of the enemies that had thrown themselves against it. They had defeated them, and they did that by a few things. They were great at adopting technologies. They were inventors and innovators themselves, but they also were great at stealing other people's ideas, the Greeks, the Celts, the Persians, the people they came up with. They were terrific at taking these ideas and making them their own and improving it, incorporating it into their own fighting system. They were incredibly disciplined. Any one of these, now these are big, these are good big strapping soldiers here. They're all in good shape, as you can see. But your average Roman probably would have been somewhat shorter than Julius here. He probably had about that tall, probably a fairly stocky guy, a fit guy. But he wouldn't have been a huge, hulking barbarian like they all came with. Some of these Germans, some of these Celts they came up with were big guys, big muscular guys, and they'd been raised their whole lives to be warriors. They were raised in a warrior culture. They were trained to, from birth, they were trained to be ferocious warriors, to prove it to everybody. They're the greatest, they're the strongest, they're going to prove it to their whole tribe that they're the biggest and the strongest. And consequently, you have a tribe of people all trying to prove that they're the biggest and the strongest. And any one of these guys, if you matched them up against a Roman soldier, might beat the living crap out of them. I mean, they might be much bigger, much stronger. But it's the discipline that made the Roman army different. They didn't fight as 5,000 individuals. They fought as one machine.
Now, in all fairness, okay, there's going to be a veritable spectrum of people in the Roman army. Because at the time that we're representing, as Cantorio has said, we're in the time of Hadrian, where the empire stretching from Spain all the way in the west to just about to the gates of Persia in the east, north to the to Scotland at the Antonine Wall, and south to North Africa. Some say even in between there. We have some evidence that there were some Romans around Central Africa on very limited little kamikaze expeditions looking for gold. But, so, within this great expanse of geography, you have a variable spectrum of people. But what we're trying to put forth is that you might have guys that are really big and really wide, but the traditional barbarian was an individual, was the rugged individualist, was the lone warrior, and everybody was out for their own personal gain and their own glory. But the Roman army fought as a unit. There was strength in numbers. It was a collective mentality.
Exactly. It was that discipline combined with their technological advantage and their ability to mass produce things. Any of these cultures they came up against could produce individual works of art. They could produce individual great pieces of armor and equipment that are just beautiful to look at today and must have been amazing, formidable back then. But the Romans could do it on an industrial scale, even before industrial times, before there were such things as machines. And I think what I'd like to do is take you two gentlemen, you two milites, pick up your gear and move over to that side so that this side of the class can feast their eyes. While we, so we can spread this out a little bit more evenly. Now you can see the equipment that they're wearing. You see a variety of equipment here. This is, Pontius here would be your standard legionary. And he is equipped, every legionary is gonna have body armor, he's gonna have weapons of a certain time, he's gonna have a helmet. Everything might not be identical to the guy next to him, but it's all gonna serve its purpose. Now the type of body armor that the Romans used from early times, from the Republic on, chainmail, and it survived the Roman Empire and went way on into the medieval times, and even today, you have forms of chainmail being worn in certain circumstances. It's basically made up of thousands of these little iron rings, and they're all linked together, and they're riveted together. You've got a solid ring, and then a ring that's round, that's flattened at one side, and a rivet put through it, and you basically weave fabric out of it. And this type of armor is great against a slashing cut. If I came at him and I slashed at him, it's gonna pretty much saw. It's not the best thing against a direct thrust or an arrow, but on the advantageous side, it's very flexible, conforms to your body. It's air conditioned, as it were. Air can pass through those holes, and it can be tailored to fit just about your individual soldier, and it's gonna. You can wear it for a long period of time without getting exhausted or fatigued. He carries in his right hand here the Roman secret weapon. The legions were armed with this. As you can see, all of our soldiers here have the pilum. The pilum is it's not a thrusting spear. It looks like a spear, but it's a javelin. It's a throwing weapon. And it has a certain advantage to it, certain advantages. It has this long shaft. This can penetrate the shield and keep right on going. This narrow pyramidal point here will go right through. It'll keep right on going. It can go right into the guy in back of it. Even if it doesn't injure or wound the guy immediately, if it strikes his shield, the shield becomes essentially useless. He has to discard the shield. One of the more interesting developments, it has a weak joint here, deliberately weak joint. So basically you throw it, and it will bend or break at that point after it impacts. Now why would you want to do that? Exactly! So you cannot pick it up and throw it back. It's a one-way weapon. Once the battle is won, you go around the field, you pick up the pilums, you fix them, you put them right back into service. But it is a one-way weapon, and it is something that the legions reserved to themselves. Only legionaries carried the pilum. Pontius, if you will pull out your sword. This is the gladius hispaniensis. A gladius, what word sounds like gladius? Gladiator. A gladiator is one who fights with a gladius or a sword. This particular form of sword, you notice it's not a very long or elegant weapon. It's not something you would fence with. You're not going to go bing, 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 bing with that. It is not a fencing weapon. It is basically for one purpose. It is for thrusting it into the guts of your enemy, or taking it into their femoral artery, or taking it up here. It is basically a thrusting weapon. So your Roman legionary is going to line up. They're going to line up in formation. They're going to throw their pilum into the enemy formation as they're coming on. That's going to break up their enemy formation. It's going to stop them. They're going to be dealing with that. Then your soldiers will draw their swords and advance with a slight distance between them, just enough to give them enough room to work their sword. They're going to advance into the enemy. They're going to advance at a steady pace and at the command of Poro! Then everybody charges into the enemy. And then it's basically smash them in the face, stick them in the belly, smash them in the face, push them back with that shield. This shield is a weapon in and of itself. It's defensive and it's offensive. You're going to be shoving them back. This boss can be smashed into somebody's face. The shield can be used. Yes. It can be an offensive weapon. You can smash somebody's foot with it. You can raise it up and push them back. And then, as soon as they're exposed, thrust them into the belly. Smash them in the face. Thrust them in the belly. Smash them in the face. Thrust them in the belly. Repeat as needed. This is the Roman technique of fighting. It is not particularly a pretty thing. There's no great elegance to it. The elegance is involved in how you arrange your formations against the enemy, but it is amazingly effective. I mean, if you can train thousands of men to do the same thing and to hold their formation and not be broken up, you can conquer an entire world. And that's exactly what the Romans did. Now, we see here regular legionaries. A legion, we had the question before, how many men is in a legion? And we had all kinds of different answers. The Romans had approximately 30 legions on station around the empire at any time. A legion consists of, it's broken into smaller groups. You start with a contubernium, eight guys, and a mule and a tent. That's a contubernium. 10 contuberniums equals a century. And a century is commanded by a centurion. How many men do you think might be in a century?
80.
80. So I already gave you the math, so you should have been able to do that. That's very good. Most people say 100 because a century sounds like 100, right? I mean, it's an obvious answer. And at one time in the distant Roman past, probably it was 100 guys, or it might be that there were 80 combatants and 20 non-combatants. You might have had servants, muleteers, people that actually took care of, basically slaves, people to run things in the army in the back room. So it might have all equaled 100 men, but there were 80 fighting men in a century, and a centurion commanded a century. Now, you group 6 centuries into a cohort. Becomes a cohort. You hear that term cohort, me and my cohorts, right? Cohort goes back to the Roman Empire. A cohort is a segment of a Roman legion. 6 centuries make it a cohort, so that's what? Do the math, let's see here. 6 times, 480 men, exactly. And 10 cohorts makes a legion. So how many men in a legion? 4,800 is what it comes out to. Actually, in practice, it was usually somewhat more than that, because at the time of the Emperor Hadrian, the first cohort was double strength. There were actually 160 men in each century. So the cohort was bigger. So a legion, and then you had other people in the legion, besides fighting men, and you had engineers, you had scouts, people who ride horseback, delivered messages, delivered dispatches. You had medical officers. You had people in there that dealt with specific things in the legion, just like in any modern army. There were specialists. So when you add it all up, a legion is somewhere between 5,000 and 5,500 men. And there were 30 of these scattered around the Roman Empire. And besides the legions, there were also the auxiliaries. Now, the auxiliaries were soldiers who were not Roman citizens. Every Roman legionary had to be a citizen of the Roman Empire. And when that started out, that meant you were basically an Italian, because people who lived in Italy, Italy was very early on absorbed under Roman rule, and everybody in Italy essentially became a Roman citizen. But as the empire got bigger and bigger, it spread out bigger and bigger into Gaul, into North Africa, into Asia Minor, into Britain. People all over were given the grant of Roman citizenship. It was a reward, because it meant you were exempt from certain taxes, and you came under Roman law. If you were out in the provinces, you were charged with something, or if you ran afoul of some local chieftain, you could always say, "Ibi sono Romana sum," I am a Roman citizen. Your law does not apply to me. Only Roman law applies to me. So I cannot be tried by any of the local yokels. You have to take me back to Rome, or you have to send a Roman magistrate out to try me. And I can only be tried on Roman law. There are privileges to being a Roman citizen. Only legionaries could only be Roman citizens. Auxiliaries could be the local people, anybody recruited locally. And that meant that Syrians and Gauls and Britons and North Africans, Numidians, people from all over the Roman Empire could become Roman auxiliaries. And once you've served your term in the Roman auxiliaries, then you got a plaque. You got a little bit of a diploma. Just like when you graduate from the academy here, you will receive a diploma. Well, once you've served your time in the auxiliaries, you will get a diploma saying, I am now a Roman citizen. Not only am I a Roman citizen, but my wife and children are now Roman citizens, and everybody descended from me here on out are Roman citizens. And that way, they extended the whole privilege of citizenship throughout the Roman Empire. And they basically made the whole world part of Rome. Pretty smart, yeah? So we've dealt with how big a legion is. We've dealt with how many men are in it, how many there were. Now let's get down to some of the duties of a Roman legion. As I pointed out before, the Roman legions were the police force of a huge empire. And when you have an empire that size, well, you have to, you know, you have to keep it under control. You have to keep the taxes flowing, because like any modern state, what keeps it running are taxes. These guys were all paid. Legionaries aren't doing this just because for the fun of it. They're doing it because they're professionals. They're getting paid. And do we have our little cash sack here?
We do. In the Lucullus bag.
Yeah, the Roman state used money as a form of propaganda. It was a way to pass information around. Your coins had the image of the emperor on one side, and on the other side, or the emperor's wife, or the emperor's relations, anybody the emperor wanted to play up, he would put on the coins. And on the reverse, he would have some propaganda message. He would say, it would say like a personification of peace, or security, or happy times. That was the Felicitas Temps, happy times. He was telling everybody. And usually when you see messages like happy times, that means that things are really going to hell really quickly, because it's just a way of trying to calm everybody down. Oh, really? It's okay. Everything's all right. Happy times. See, it says so on the coins. And there are various kinds of coins. You had big brass ones like this. The silver denarius was sort of like the $5. Silver denarius was like about a $20 bill. And Roman legionaries got paid... in the time of Hadrian, got paid 300 silver denarii a year, so that comes out to $6,000. Doesn't sound like a lot, but remember that a Roman legionary, his meals are all paid for, his medical care is paid for, his housing and everything like that is all paid for by the state. So that $6,000 or that 300 denarii a year is basically just kind of spending money. Or you can put it into a legion bank. The aquilifer, the guy who holds the eagle, this guy right here, is the legion's banker. He was in charge of keeping everybody's accounts. And if you wanted to take some of your money, have a little deduction, pass it on to the aquilifer, he sets it aside, he starts an account up for you, gives you interest and all this kind of stuff. It was just like today. They had a lot of the same institutions as today. He would keep it in a big strong box. And then at the end of your time in the army, you got your retirement bonus plus whatever money you've been setting aside. So you can retire with a nice chunk of change.
And when we before we started the class, we had I had the fortune or the pleasure of listening to a little video that was on. It was about I guess some contributions from your payroll toward like a health and welfare type of association for the families of fallen police officers. Well, the Roman army had something similar, and what we do know is they had what was called a burial club, and a portion of each soldier's pay per pay period would be put toward the burial club. So if he died in service, his funeral would be paid for. We don't know for sure if any money would go to the widow or the legal widow, because soldiers were away from their families for quite some time. A lot of them had common law spouses and children who were not citizens. But we do know that the soldier was buried, and out of the expense of his burial club donations. And the aquilifer would have been the one also to take care of those monies.
And one reason we know today... How do we know what a Roman soldier looked like? Well, there's various different things. There's sculptural evidence. there's actual pieces. They found several crates of this type of armor. Archaeologists found this in northern England, a place called Corbridge, in a Roman fort. They excavated it. They found a chest, about that size of a chest, crammed with 16 different pieces of this type of armor. And of course, a lot of it had oxidized and had turned to kind of rust, but they were able to pull all of this apart and examine it in detail. We know in detail, down to the rivet, how this equipment was made. Also, same thing with pilum pieces, swords, little fragments of armor. These are found all over the Roman Empire.
And I think one of history's mysteries in a small sense is that there was so many different pieces of armor in a chest of this dimension, and the chest was locked using a Roman locking system, and it does actually work. It keeps people from timeline events out of your visitors out of your chest. But I'm not sure exactly why they would lock up pieces of what we would think was scrap armor, but it was valuable to somebody. So.
Metal was always valuable in the ancient world. Remember, they didn't have modern machines to dig it out of the ground, smelt it, everything. Everything was done by hand. The Romans had a form of mass production, but it's not what we would recognize as mass production. It was like serial single production. They had hundreds and hundreds of artisans basically working on the same thing at the same time, rather than an assembly line where they had this piece and that piece. So that way, their technology, they were able to make things in big quantities, but it was different from the kind of mass production we have today. But as I was touching on the burial club, one of the reasons we know why Roman soldiers are what they look like, especially centurions, is because of the habit. Once they had their burial club, they were able to put up, if they died, they were able to put up a monument and put a statue of themselves on it. And often you have the soldier standing there in his full gear, his full equipment. And some of these sculptures are so good, you can count the individual little scales in their armor and the individual little plates on their belts. And everything is perfectly done. And so you can look at that. It's almost like looking at a photograph. You can see, from 2,000 years ago, you can see exactly how this guy was equipped and what he carried. Now, specifically, a centurion. Now, you can look at my gear and see that it differs somewhat from my men. In what way am I different from them? Anybody?
The feathers on your head.
Feathers on my head, right. A centurion had to be seen, and he didn't leave. He wasn't like a lot of modern officers sort of sit back at the, you know, at the back of the battle and say, oh, send these guys over here, send these guys over here. You know, they're not on the radio phone, or they're not on the, on the walkie-talkie giving directions from the back. A centurion fought from the front. He was at the very front of the line. He was at the front to the far right of the formation. He was out there with his sword, just like his other guys. And his guys had to see him. And that is why his crest, when he wore a crest, it was sideways, transverse crest. So his men could see him and key off of whatever he was doing. Unfortunately, that has a disadvantage. What might that disadvantage be?
The enemy knows. Right.
The enemy can also see you quite clearly. They can see, oh, that guy's a centurion. Kill him. So centurions suffered very high battle casualty rates. And we know this from people like Julius Caesar wrote an account of his conquest of Gaul in very great detail. He said, and he would list, this many soldiers were killed and this many centurions. And this number of, the ratio of centurions to soldiers killed was always much higher than one out of 80 guys. You'd think that a centurion is one of 80 guys. Well, he's 1/80th of the casualties. No, he's like 1/3 of the casualties. So they got killed a lot. And that's because their centurions fought from the front line. They led their men into battle, and they were expected to. If their men had to do a fighting retreat, he was expected to send them all. He was covering for them. So the centurions often would hate their centurion. The soldiers would hate their centurion. For what reason, I don't know, because sometimes he was called to mete out punishment on his soldiers. You know, he would get, if somebody got out of line, that's what this was for. He was supposed to give them a good whack with that. There were centurions that were legendary for meeting out such heavy discipline. There was one of them that was called, hand me another. Now think about that. Hand me another. That meant that with his vine staff, he would wail on his men so hard, he would break the staff, and he'd say, hand me another, and he'd go right back at it. Naturally, their men hated it. would hate their centurions. And there are probably incidents of what you call fragging today, you know. A centurion would be there at the front and something would come in from the back, you know. But basically, a centurion put his life on his line for his men. And he was expected to be the first one, one of the first ones into combat, and one of the last ones off the field. So a lot of times, as we noted, the casualties are really high. I didn't want to pass you up. You had a question back there.
Oh, sir, I wanted to ask, when a centurion is killed, how do they choose who's next?
Ah, good question. The next, because there's an order, there's a ladder of rank. There is a ladder of command, just like in the modern army. The next guy down from the centurion was called the optio. The optio was equipped somewhat similarly to regular legionary, but he had a few little different things about his equipment, and he carried a staff with a ball on the end. And while the centurion lined up at the front, the optio was at the back, and he had that staff to keep the men in line, and if anybody started to back out, he pushed them right back into line again with that staff. If the centurion goes down, the optio steps right in. He's the commander of that unit. If the optio goes down, the tesserarius stands in. If the tesserarius goes down, the standard bearer, the signifer, goes in. There's a ladder of command in any century, and there's a ladder of the centurionate. A legion, as we said, was organized into centuries and into cohorts, and they're numbered. First century, first cohort, sixth century, tenth cohort, all the way down to the end. And the centurions of these various cohorts are all ranked in their order. The first centurion of the first cohort is the primus filius. That's me. He's going to be the top centurion in the entire legion. And if he survived that long, because we talked about warfare, casualties, he's really good at what he does. If he survived long enough to become a primus filius. Or he's really lucky. Or there haven't been that many wars, you know. I mean, but generally, a first centurion of a legion is a very experienced guy. He's been in the army for 15, 20 years. He's survived that length of time. He knows all the ins and outs. Really, he's the guy that runs the legion. There's a general over him. The generals were aristocrats. There were aristocrat officers. It's sort of like modern, you have the non-com officers and you have the commissioned officers. There's kind of that, it doesn't work exactly that same way, but we have aristocrat officers in the Roman army, and you have the grunts, the guys who work their way up. Generally, centurions work their way up. They were generally career soldiers. So they tended, you know, even if you got to be a primus pilus, you're not exactly an aristocrat. The general, these other guys, the tribunes in the legion, they would be outrank you. But generally, a smart general is going to go, in any situation, is going to turn to the primus pilus and says, what do we do now? And the primus pilus says, I think we should arrange the guys this way. We should do the triplex actae formation. And we should move these guys and put the cavalry over there. And then we'll come at them from the sides and we'll do this. And the general will say, yeah, great idea. Do that. So the primus pilus is really going to be the guy who knows how the legion runs, and it all runs through him. And his pay is about 50 times what that of a Roman legionary is, a regular legionary. So as you go up in rank, you get more and more money. Yeah.
Sir, how will you rank up, or what do you have to do?
To raise in the ranks of the Roman army, you just have to show initiative. You have to be a good soldier. You have to have obeyed, you know, you have to know how to obey orders and to show initiative when the time is right. You can't be a malingerer. It's like the modern army. You have to know the ins and outs of the military law, how it works. You probably have to kiss a few butts, you know. You have to do pretty much, it probably is very similar to what you'd see in the modern army. You know, to rise up through the ranks to get promoted. You have to be good at what you're doing. Once you become a primus, a top centurion, I'll take one more question and then we'll hold the rest until the very end and then you can just ask away. Yeah.
So I wanted to ask, was there any medical legionaries?
There was. There were medical officers in the Roman legion. The chief medical officer was called the medicus. Makes good sense, right? And then he had guys under him called capsarii. and they were the medics. They were the battlefield medics. A capsarius carries a capsa, and this is his medical kit. And he would have in here all of his little tools of his trades, things for extracting arrows, things for cauterizing, sealing, and cauterizing wounds, staples, wound staples. They are actually more advanced than anybody for centuries thereafter, using silver staples to close wounds with. Bandages, wraps, things like that.
If you're interested in a Roman army medical demonstration, we do have two videos on our website. Our medicus is in San Diego, so it was a bit of a logistical issue to get him up here this time of morning. But we do have a couple videos, and there are some close-ups of the bronze tools that they use at the time.
So yes, he was one of the specialists within the Legion. And medical care came under, when you joined the Roman army, you got free medical care, which is very rare in the ancient world. That was a few things that would encourage you. Through most of the Roman history, they didn't have to draft people. They didn't have to force them to join the army. The life was attractive enough to people who would want to join the Roman army because you got a regular paycheck. You got paid. Regular intervals. That was very unusual in the ancient world. The pay wasn't too bad. It wasn't wonderful, but it was surviving. It was a living wage. You got a lot of stuff taken care of for you, meals, etc. And you had benefits when you retired. You got a retirement bonus. You either got a piece of land somewhere to work as your own, or you got a money bonus, cash. As I said, the auxiliaries had the added incentive. If you join as an auxiliary and you're not a Roman citizen, when you retire from the auxiliaries, you become a Roman citizen. So it was a system that was very sophisticated in its way to draw people in. It communitized people that were out in the province. It made them want to become part of the Roman Empire, Roman army. And for most of the empire, especially in the period we're talking about, the middle, talking about from the time of Augustus Caesar, right around the turn of the century, right around the time of Christ, right before the time, about the time he was born, the time he was crucified, Augustus to Tiberius, you had what you could call peace, the Pax Romana. There were occasional brushfire wars. There were civil wars, one emperor taking on contender to taking on another. But these were usually brief and quick, and they were over with within a few months. You didn't have long, grinding, slogging periods of warfare as you'd had in the centuries previous to that. You didn't have barbarians just riding into every villages and riding through and seizing things and killing people and dragging people off into slavery. You didn't do that because the Roman army wouldn't hold with that. They'd go out and they'd find those barbarians and they'd hunt them down and those war bands. And they either drive them out or they killed them. So you had peace and you had order within the Roman army, Roman Empire. Yes, you had to pay taxes, but most people did the equation and went, yeah, it's worth it. I'll pay my taxes.
So you're going to see that at different periods of time, politically, that you're going to see in times of peace or in times of warfare, you're going to see an acceleration or a deceleration of change in equipment. And so I think that's kind of important. The time that we're at is a time of peace. So you're going to have equipment staying in service for a longer period of time. But in the early part of the empire, in the transition from the Republic to the early part of the empire, you're going to see a more accelerated evolution of equipment. And that's why we brought some of the helmets here. I wanted to demonstrate that there are some market developments in helmets in quite a short period of time, sometimes 25 to 50 years. That doesn't sound like a short period of time, but in the greater span of history, it's really a drop in the bucket, quite literally. So if we can talk about these types of helmets, would you like to?
Yeah. As I said before,
just add that you're going to see not only in the army, but in related things, like we'll talk about in a little bit a while about the gladiator equipment, that equipment changes in response to the equipment and the strategy and tactics of the enemies of Rome or who you're fighting. So this represents our earliest helmet that we're going to talk about today. This is the Monte Fortino helmet. David, you want to talk about it? Or
sure.
As
I was saying before, if you ask what a Roman soldier looked like at different times, he looked different, just like an American soldier. This would be like the equivalent of the Civil War or World War I American soldier. This is the Monte Fortino type helmet, and it's a copy off of a Celtic design. The Romans encountered the Celts first in about 300 BC. The Celts were these wild people that lived up in the northern areas of Europe, Gaul, Britain. They swept down into Italy right around 300 BC, or the 400 BC. They swept down. They actually overran Rome. The Roman legions, they just brushed the Roman legions aside, and they just ran right over, and they actually took the city of Rome for a while.
But they weren't they weren't one huge linear migration. Yeah. Let me just point out very quickly that Celtic, it's a huge expanse of different Celtic language-speaking people. Rome started its helmet development on this end here by when Julius Caesar moved into Gaul and he encountered the Gallic tribes.
Well, this type of helmet was basically a Celtic design. And the Romans, they saw how easily their Greek-style equipment had been defeated by the Celtic-style gear. The Celts were master metalsmiths. They produced chainmail, which is the Romans had never really encountered before. Once they saw the chainmail, they adopted it. They adopted it into their own army. They adopted the Celtic helmet.
And this stayed in
use for about 300 years. This was like the most popular Roman helmet for the longest time, from the time of Hannibal. In the 3rd century, like around 250s BC, all the way to the time of Julius Caesar, just before the time of Christ. This was probably the most common Roman helmet.
And we do know that the Greeks did, of course, go into Italy and settled in southern Italy and the Campania area, and it was called Magna Graecia. We do see evidence of Greek-style helmets. But if you think about, you know, everyone thinks of the 300 and the closed-face helmets. Now, how would that would not have worked in the Italian peninsula as the Romans started to gain power with the Italic type of enemy, or the Gauls, because they didn't fight in block. They needed to see. And something like this was much more advantageous because you do have a lot of, you can see and you can pretty much hear.
And it's a simple helmet that's easy to mass produce. Uh-huh. As time went on, the Romans started adding little features to it. This is called a coolest type helmet, and it's kind of a development from the Monte Fortino helmet. And you can see they added this to the front. That is to stop a blow from coming in this way. You can think of it as the visor on a modern riot type helmet, tactical helmet. Almost the same type of design. And it, like that, it also has an extension in the back to protect your neck. This has a much bigger flare in the back, and it has these big cheek pieces to protect your cheeks. And it has added little features, a little knob to attach a crest to.
And little feather holders, too.
Little feather plume holders, right. And then another development of that was the Imperial Gallic. This is an early Imperial Gallic type helmet. And you can see they've shifted from brass or bronze over to iron. The Celts were master ironsmiths. Iron's more durable metal. I mean, it's gonna stop a lot more. A thinner section of iron is going to be stronger and more resistant to piercing blows, to hammer blows, to blunt trauma than a brass helmet would be. So this is what we call a Gallic A-type helmet. And as time went on, it developed into the later Gallic model, the Gallic G-type helmet, which is much fancier. As time goes on, they tend to get fancier and fancier, and had, you know, besides useful features, they also have little decorative things, like the little floral bosses. Other kinds of...
And then I'll point out Matt cross bracing on the top of his helmet.
Right.
Now that is an engineering result of this type of an enemy that they would have encountered when Rome started to get past the Danube in what we call the Trans-Danubian area, where they were fighting completely different. The tribes were using longer, heavier swords or something called a falx, and they would swing overhand.
The falx is basically like a scythe, almost like a farming implement. Two-handed sword. And the Romans, when they encountered the Dacians for the first time, were shocked that the scythe would come down and the point would go right through the helmet. And they lost a lot of men that way. So and you can see it happen archaeologically. You find this type of helmet with these pieces retrofitted to it, these iron cross beams retrofitted to the helmet to stop that piercing blow. And then as time went on, this became a regular feature of the helmet. You started to add it from the beginning, even put little decorative little things in there to pretty it up.
And then also the widened and elongated net guard. It's probably the widest that it got in the Roman Empire.
Mm-hmm. And also this form of body armor, the lorica segmentata. You see this in movies. You see it on Trajan's column. This is Emperor Trajan marched into Dacia and conquered it, and he also conquered what we now call Iran, Iraq. Had the same experience the Americans had in Iran, Iraq. When he got in there, he found that it was easy to conquer, not so easy to hold. So they eventually pulled out of Iran, Iraq. They left a puppet king in their place, and it was almost like history repeating itself as you see today. But the form of armor you see most on the Trajan's column, which is a wonderful piece of architecture in Rome. It's a column with like a spiral relief. It looks like a cartoon strip showing the conquest of Dacia on this, and the soldiers, there's hundreds and hundreds of soldiers shown, and most of them are wearing this type of armor, the lorica segmentata. And this came into use right around the time of Christ, maybe a little bit before that, right around the turn. You know, you go from about maybe 10 or 20 BC, it came into use. And it seems to be a completely Roman invention. The Romans adopted other people's type of armor, but in this case, they seem to have invented this directly. It was a Roman invention, and it might have come out of gladiatorial equipment, the stuff that happened in the arena. They started to see how effective some of that was, and they adopted it to the military. But this type of armor, as I like to demonstrate, is probably the most protective type of body armor that was invented in the ancient world. They could produce lots and lots of it. It was munitions grade. They could mass produce it. It didn't have to be so closely tailored, and it would resist just about anything. I mean, yeah. I mean, it is completely resistant to a penetrating blow, to a thrust. Nothing's going to get through that. And besides that, if you were to say swing at somebody with a big club, you know, some of the barbarians you came up with had nothing more armed with nothing more than a club. If you swung it at him, you know, this would take the force of the blow and it would send it right through to the limb underneath it. So he might get a broken arm, or he might suffer a huge contusion. You know, he'd be wearing a padded undergarment under this, which would take some of that, but this is not so great. Great against slashing blows, not so much against blunt trauma. This, on the other hand, he can hammer away all that, and he's barely going to feel it, because it will absorb the force of the blow. So that type of armor came into use right around the time of Christ, and continued for about 250, 300 years, and then abruptly it stops, it drops out of use, and like around 300 A.D. You almost never see the lorica segmentata anymore. And it's interesting because why would such an effective form of armor stop being used? Anybody have any ideas about that?
Mobilization?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
We're coming into a period of time where the empire is moving farther east. They're encountering different types of warfare, different types of fighting. The Army has gotten, because of a peripheral economic crisis, the Army has changed its structure. It needs to be more mobile, and this does not work well on horses.
And also, it's a wonderful piece of armor to look at. It's very effective in the field. It is a maintenance nightmare. It is very difficult to keep that in good shape. All of these little fastenings and fittings on it are rust traps. Rust develops in there, weakens it, falls apart. You have to scrub away at it all the time. It has lots of straps on the inside. They break. Even as reenactors, we use this part. The loricas are breaking often, right? I mean, they come apart. And so you have to spend time banging away at it to fix it. It is the perfect armor for an empire that is mostly at peace. And from the time of Christ until about 250 AD, the empire was mostly at peace. A legion would be called up to fight maybe once every couple of years. Mostly it's just patrol duties, training all the time, patrolling the frontiers, keeping the barbarians out, keeping local disturbances at a minimum. Starting in about AD 200, 220, it all changes. There's more and more enemies starting to attack the empire from different sides. You've got the barbarians, the Germans attacking in the north against the Rhine and the Danube frontier. They're starting to punch through the populations. The population on the outside is growing. The population on the inside, the Roman Empire, is stopped. It's kind of like modern America. The population flattened out and it stopped growing. And then in the later second century, you had a terrible plague. A plague probably wiped out a quarter of the people in the Roman Empire. Even with all the great medical care and everything they had, they were still completely vulnerable when a plague came wiping through. So suddenly you had a lower population on this side. The barbarians are growing. They're seeing that for hundreds of years, this civilization on that side of the frontier, on that side of the river, on that side, those guys have got cities, they've got bathhouses, they've got markets, they've got roads, they've got all this great stuff. What have we got on this side? We've got our farm, our dirt farm, little life, and we've got people raiding all the time, and we've got, you know, I want what they've got. So they started pouring over the frontiers. They started punching through, and the legions couldn't stop it all. They were just, they overwhelmed the local legions. And for 150 years, you had constant warfare. And the Persians were attacking in the east, the barbarians in the north. Suddenly, that time of peace that was all forgotten, suddenly legions were called up any given moment. You need to pack your stuff and move there. They're punching through the frontier there. No, oh no, now they're over there. Oh no, this guy is revolted now. Now he's proclaiming himself emperor. You have to go out and put him down. Get over there. So suddenly legions were marching everywhere. The combat was continuous. You didn't have time to sit there and fuss with your armor every day to make sure that it was nice. Something like a chainmail shirt, well, that doesn't require much maintenance. You just throw that on, or scale armor, like what I'm wearing, scale armor.
Okay, so that's the big picture of what's happening. If you close your eyes and imagine, that's the big picture of what's happening on the periphery of the empire. That's the macro view. Mm-hmm. Now, let's just try to pull it forward and bring it up in time and just think about, okay, so what then would a soldier, if he was meeting somebody, you know, somebody in a hostile situation, you know, on a one-to-one type of a combat, one-to-one, what would he use? I see over here, this is kind of what I'm interested in, this over here. Now, this is something that is a baton?
Mm-hmm.
Well, John, maybe you can explain this in relation to Roman equipment.
All right. So, I like it. Also classical. So, you can also look at it. Not too much water. This weapon also is the same thing that it's shield. When we use this in the LAPD, out of control. I can do the exact same thing with the shield. So the same tactics that we use for the shield are used with the baton. Also, we use this edge for jabbing. So the only thing is that LAPD, we don't use shields right now. Jab, jab. Everything this shield is used for, I use with this baton.
And we'll point out that if you look around the world and see riot control shields being used everywhere, it's exactly the same dimensions as the Roman scutum. The same dimensions, the same curve, everything. And it's used in almost exactly the same way.
This guy, same thing, jab. Same thing. This that we use for the department is the same thing as using both the shield and the sword mixed into one.
The only difference would be that this would be considered a non-lethal weapon, right?
This is still lethal.
This can still be lethal?
This is a lethal weapon.
Probably not as lethal as the gladius, though.
Not quite as sharp.
Yeah. And actually, Michael has served, he's been in the Marines. He's actually seen both sides. Can you talk to what some of the similarities are and some of the differences between a modern Marine and what a Roman legionary is?
Well, I'd say on one hand, most of your protection is going to be in your torso again. Your legs, if you're in the military, I mean, you're wearing pants, you're maybe some knee pads, something, but your legs you're not too worried about. But you are worried about your internal organs. If you're wearing a flat vest, if you're wearing things like that. I haven't worn a whole lot of chainmail. This equipment is roughly, if I was going to wear a flak jacket, this would weigh a little bit more. It would pinch in the shoulders a little bit differently. So modern body armor is also meant to be a little more comfortable. At the same time, this, I can breathe a lot better. Breeze can go through me and I feel okay, where with our stuff, it gets sweaty, it gets heavy, it sticks to your body, it can be more problematic. Let's see, I mean, in terms of if you're looking at what a modern soldier Marine would carry, do we have a furcal pole here?
Yep. Yeah, this would be the Roman equivalent of a backpack. And he would be carrying an entrenching tool of some kind. You'd be carrying a pickaxe, which the Romans would call a delabra. That would be part of the kit. And he would have a few days' rations in here. He'd have his bedroll.
And not to forget to hydrate.
So he'd need his canteen.
Roman canteen. And this is an ancient design, by the way. So it has not changed a lot.
So this is what he'd be carrying on his back when he was just on the march.
Not very tactical, not very efficient. Someone ambushed, this, and then you're carrying a shield. You're carrying two pilum. So it's a little cumbersome. So nowadays, I mean, we have our stuff in base. Maybe we're carrying a day pack. We're carrying light gear. Our weapons are much lighter, easier to use. So there's some similarity. But, I mean, mind you, technology has changed dramatically. So the life of a soldier or Marine is much easier now. So I don't think they'd like to be wearing this for, you know, 20-mile march and going through combat. We don't want to, this would not be so effective.
On the other hand, it is interesting that for centuries, after the Roman period and, you know, a soldier through medieval times would armor up. The armor actually got more and more and more and more until you had the medieval knights that were basically head to foot and the visors and everything. They were covered with armor. And then gunpowder is invented, and abruptly all that armor disappears because it is found to be ineffective against bullets. Bullets will go through plate armor. So from about 1500 to in the late 1900s, soldiers did not wear any body armor at all. They just wore their uniform and a helmet, something to protect their head. But now they wear body armor again. They've come back into it. It's in a way, it is overlapping plates of ceramic, which is in a similar kind of fashion design to this, kind of a harness of plates. It's covered by fabric now. But once again, you're wearing body armor, you're wearing torso armor, and you're using shields, riot control shields, which are very similar to what things that the Romans would use to control crowds in almost exactly the same way. Now, as long as we're talking about controlling crowds, policing, all of these things, What about the actual, what about actual policing? There's army work, you know, fighting the enemy, but what about actually controlling crime, controlling riots and such within, like a city, like the city of Rome? Well, Laurie's done a lot of study about that, and I'll let her talk about that for a bit.
Well, we hear more about, we know that crime is as old as, humankind, as old as even before we have civilization. But before we have evidence, real written evidence, archaeological and epigraphical evidence for policing in antiquity, we have evidence for firefighting units. The earliest mention of a fire brigade, per se, was actually a private fire brigade of about 500 to 600 men. And one could say it was owned by one man named Marcus Licinius Crassus. The name may or may not be familiar to any of you, but he was one third of the first triumvirate with Julius Caesar. And he was a very, very rich man, and he was born around 115, 116 BC. And Plutarch tells us that he gained an enormous amount of wealth through fire and rapine. And we know there are some very infamous stories about him, and his 500 or 600 firefighters. They would go around Rome. And this is right before we have, we think that the numbers by the time of Augustus, let me go forward a bit, time of Augustus, about 6-7 AD, I want to say about the beginning of the imperial period, Rome had approximately 1 million inhabitants, 423 neighborhoods, and on record 147,000 public buildings, including temples, shrines, warehouses, courts, etc. Now that's a lot of structures in a small amount of space. Now before Augustus, most everything was built of wood. And in such a small proximity, I don't know if any of you have ever been to Rome, but it's very small. It's a very finite amount of space. Everything was built, and they did build in multi-stories, in wood. So as Dave likes to coin the phrase, all Rome was a tinderbox. So going back to the time of Crassus, everything caught fire, and fire jumped. So he would, you know, saunter onto the property of the distressed owner whose building is going up, with his fire brigade, and he would try to negotiate a price. And if they would go ahead and agree, these guys would put out the fire with their buckets, or their grapple hooks, or their big pieces of leather soaked in vinegar and water.
And the longer you waited, the lower the price got.
Right. And then after a while, if the owner just said, sorry, no, they would wait till it just burned to the ground, and then he would just buy it wholesale from them. Buy this, and then he would
buy it at the distressed auction.
Exactly.
And so, that way he ended up owning a good chunk of Rome, the real estate in Rome. Mm-hmm.
So that's our very first evidence of that. But when Augustus took power, he started an organization that he called the Vigiles, or the Militia Vigilum.
What word does that sound like? Vigiles,
yes.
Vigiles.
Vigilante.
Vigilant.
Exactly. And Augustus made a lot of administrative, he really changed Rome. He said that he found Rome a brick, and he made it a city of marble. But in actuality, he just sort of faced it over with marble. But in any case, he got rid of the wood. And he broke up Rome into 14 administrative districts. And he created 7 cohorts of firefighters, policemen, night watchmen. And if you do the math, I wasn't born with the math gene, so I had to read this twice. So basically, each cohort was broken up into a statio, or a station, sounds like station, and an excubitorium, which is sort of a guardhouse. And there were 2 of these in the district. So there were 7 cohorts of vigiles, or vigiles, as we say in Latin, and 14 administrative districts. So they were concentrated primarily in Rome. Now, by the time of the Emperor Tiberius, we know that there was a very large cohort of vigiles in Rome's biggest port city called Ostia Antica. And the this was, I've actually visited the barracks there, and we think that it is a barracks built, it was, these barracks were taken over by the cohort of vigilantes, usually from private, through private sales. They were villas because they occupied a large amount of space. And what they were is that these were basically firefighters with some policing duties. And we know through our records in Rome that they were broken down into different types of firefighters. For example, we have the vigiles aquarii. And can you, anybody guess what they, what might have been there in their purview? Yes, exactly. And we have the vigiles balnearii. Those are the ones that patrol the baths. Now, why would you need firefighters in a bath and all the many, many bathhouses? We think, okay, maybe they weren't firefighters, obviously, but they were most likely security against pickpocketing and crimes of opportunity that happened at bathhouses because people would check their clothes into little cubby holes. So we have sort of a security force going through there. And then you have another group called the vigiles Oriarii, which patrolled the gardens. Now, in Rome, the gardens were huge places of leisure and walking, again, most likely at night, great opportunities for crimes of opportunity. And they also evolved to protect the grain warehouses. Now, you see graffiti of this in Ostia because that is the port city and that's where all the grain went through. And there were huge grain storehouses and storerooms. So you do see a lot more evidence for this particular type of an individual, the ones that patrolled the grain warehouses, because that was very different. Everything there is very close together. And even though we know that they started to build in brick, a lot of the roofs were still wood, and there was lots of grain, lots of dry grain, you have to keep it dry, lots of straw, and lots of wood for storehouses. So that would really go up like Dave's tinderbox. Now, we have archaeological evidence for firefighters, and I tend to think of Roman soldiers and, you know, people in the ancient world as, you know, you sort of get kind of, you get a fuzzy picture of red, and you sort of get the general idea, but these were people too that have lives. Again, I've been thinking of the videos on earlier when I walked in, and they were talking about, there was a narrator saying that, you know, I'm a policeman, but, you know, policemen also have lives and families and love, and so did these people. These were actual people. So we start to, through graffiti, especially through graffiti on walls, we start to realize that these firefighters and these security men and these policemen were actually human beings, and they did things to combat boredom as well as crime. One particular incident that I saw was two inscriptions, and it was written by this was in Rome, and it's written by a night watchman, and he identifies himself. His name is Calpurnius. Wow, you actually know him. And he is what we call a sabbatiarius. And that was a man that sort of walked around. He was had some policing power, but it seemed to be a duty roster, and they would go around and they would light tallow candles. They'd walk around with tallow candles, and immediately thought, wow, this sort of sounds like the PCs, the police constables of late Victorian London. They'd walk around and they'd have the bobbies that they have candles or they'd have gaslit lamps. Well, this particular man seemed to like to graffiti, and he would write, I am Calpurnius, and, you know, under the, in the reign of, in this particular case, it was the reign of Caracalla in the 3rd century, and he lists the years of the consuls, the two officials that were in power, so we can precisely date the time that he was on duty. And he basically says that here I am and I'm on my patrol. And then he also mentions that, and he makes this inscription in a shrine, and he basically says that he hopes that this particular consul will be consul for another 10 years. I mean, it sounds sort of silly to say, well, I hope that Obama's going to be president for longer. But this is what he wrote. And we also have a lot of evidence for night watchmen that just simply write their names, or they seem to make graffiti and sign things like Sebakyariai Fekit Menze, which means they completed this duty roster for the month.
Yes. Fekit. The word is Fekit. Just to make sure. And it means F-E-C-K-E-T. You see this all over the Roman Empire. It usually means made it. I made it. So we've got just a few minutes left, I think. So we want to conclude by many of you wrote in questions. And we thank you very much for writing in these questions in advance. And we thought we'd go run through some of them and answer some of them. Yes. So we'll throw it open to questions right now. So does anybody have any questions that came to your mind? Yeah.
Sure. How would you guys communicate that more, like long distance or in between?
Long distance. Good question. There were no telephones, telegraphs in the Roman Empire. What you did have were guard towers set up at like along the frontier. There were tall towers written, and they could set signal fires, and you could actually do some form of semaphore or signaling to transmit messages that way along a frontier. The Romans had effectively a pony express, that a mail service that the army ran, that if you needed to get a dispatch from one end of the empire to the other, they could do it in about a week.
Yeah, carried these between the mile towers, yeah. Just carried scrolls.
And then they'd have a guy hop onto a horse, he'd ride to the next station, jump onto another horse, ride hell for leather, and they could deliver messages quickly that way. And then on the battlefield, in the middle of a battle, you pass signals by horns. You had actually musicians in the Roman army. That was a form of officer, and they had two different kinds of horns. They had a big sort of curly, like a very thin tuba called a cornu, and then they had a straight horn called the tuba, and you could actually you set signals, different horn blasts meant different things, and you could signal that way on the battlefield. Any other questions? Have we done such an excellent job? And do we have any of the questions written down that they wrote in advance?
Unfortunately, I forgot it on the car.
Oh, dear. Okay. Quickly touching on firefighting gear, what kinds of things did they use? How did they fight fires? Rome was a tinderbox. It burned down. There were huge fires at various times. Total sections of the city would go up. How did you fight it? They had pumpers. They had basically their technology had risen to the point where they had hand pumps. They
could bronze actually, pump engines.
You could
yes.
just direct streams of water up at fire, so they had pump engines. But more often, this tool that they used there is similar to a tool we have today. This is a pickaxe. The Romans called this a delabra. And the only way to stop a really big conflagration was to deny it fuel, and that is to tear down the houses in its path to create fire breaks. And they had actually artillery. The fire units had ballistas. They had catapults to fire grappling hooks, to fire stones at houses, to tear them down in the path of the fire to deny it fuel. That is probably where the story goes. You've heard about the fire of Rome, that Nero burned Rome down so that he could build his big golden palace. And then he sat up there on the roof fiddling or playing his lyre while the city burned. That is almost certainly not true. Nero was not a particularly great guy or a good emperor, but he didn't do that. But what people saw probably was the firefighters rushing out with their pickaxes, their ballistas, tearing houses down, trying to create fire breaks to keep the fire from spreading to different parts of it. And people said, oh, look at that, he's destroying those houses, he's ripping it down, it's him that's doing it, he's doing this. It's probably not at all true. It was exactly the opposite. They're trying to stop the fire. But people, by and large, didn't understand the tactics that were being employed. So
because nobody put out a general, they didn't put out a news bulletin that there was a creation
right.
early on of the militant, the vigilis. Nobody knew. Just men would appear, and it was this very slow process.
Yeah, I mean... Did the vigilis wear uniforms? That's something I don't even know.
We don't. Obviously, organic material is not going to survive, so we don't know what color tunics that they wore. But there are a couple of reliefs, especially at the 7th cohort of vigilis in the 13th district in Rome, which show some of the equipment. And it looks a lot like what the soldiers are wearing, except for obviously they're not wearing, it doesn't appear to be metal, they're wearing something sort of like a messenger bag. It looks like one wide strap here and a big wide belt here. And we think that it might possibly be to hang hooks and things on. And it looks like there's something that's wrapped around them. We think that might be a wet blanket or sort of like a wet piece of leather, like a chamois, that they might be able to roll and put over them or else to smother the fire.
So we now are down to...
We're down to one last question, which
yeah.
is mine.
Okay.
The question is, what is the Roman salute for a Roman emperor? What would that be?
That's a good question, but in most of the reliefs and everything, it is simply something like this. It's not like the Nazi this, and it's not like a modern salute like that, but in most cases, you see Roman soldiers addressing their officer or addressing the emperor, and they're simply raising their hand up like that. So when we salute, we simply, our guys just come to attention and raise their right hand.
So could we all do that as a class and give a salute to our Roman soldiers? Farewell.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for this opportunity.